Thank you, sir. I'll request the PIC colleagues that if we get the Honorary General Secretary, so please you would be inviting him on the stage. Thank you. So it's if you could please take the seat, sir. It's a great honor to stand here. We are 5 year old today. And as I have the opportunity to say welcome to you all, I might as well take another moment now that I have the mic to just share this tiny little thing, sir. Somewhere in 2011, it was month of August, I received a call from Dr. Kelkar and Mr. Karandikar saying, you know what, there is this new organization that we are setting up and would you want to be a member of it? I said, why not, sir? It would be great, you know, if anything that Dr. Mushilkar and Dr. Kelkar are involved with, I would be happily wanting to be a member like everyone else here, and there are many of us members out here. Then I got another call and I was invited at Dr. Kelkar's place and was told that, hey, look, Dr. Mushilkar and I have had a conversation and we would like to ask if you would like to become a director of this institute. I said, look, I could become a spot boy. Why director, you know? So I was very, very glad. Mr. Karandikar, if you could request you to please come on stage, sir. So that's where the journey began. It's 5 years and time has flown by, but wonderful things have happened in PIC. A lot about that Dr. Mushilkar would be speaking as he would tell us a bit about the journey over the last 5 years. Before I request Dr. Mushilkar, may I very briefly introduce the audience to the stage, because I'm sure that Dr. Mushilkar would be introducing the chief guest today. Sir, in the audience we have PIC trustees. Of course, you would know many others like Dr. Swaroop, Professor Malik and other scientists around here. But we have the trustees of PIC. We have the divisional commissioner and the chief of the metropolitan area. We also have people from various walks of life who are members of PIC. But as PIC is for public interest, this is not only open for members of PIC. Most of our programs are open for all the members who could come and who could make use of it. So we have many academic institutions who are our members. So many faculty and students of those institutes are also here today. And so as it's an open forum, anyone and everyone who is in Pune, a Punekar, and anyone in Pune is most welcome to attend this program. So that's introduction of the audience for you, sir. May I now request Dr. Mushilkar to please address the gathering, brief a bit about PIC's last 5 years journey, and also introduce the speaker today, the chief guest today. Dr. Mushilkar, please.
Distinguished members of Pune International Center and all our beloved Punekers who are here today, I welcome you all. This is the fifth foundation day. It has been a five-year journey, a glorious journey. It looks like yesterday, by the way, that we were founded. Just a few words about Pune International Center. We are growing in strength. We are growing in terms of our activity. We are growing in terms of our influence. And we are growing in terms of our basic charter, which is Vichar Manthan Kendra. Vichar, those thoughts which are good for India. And taking a position as a thought leader. That's what Pune International Center is. And those of you who were here a little earlier, you saw that we give respect not only to the thoughts that we all have, but to the generation that is going to build the future India. And what an hour we had with these young children from villages, and you look at their thoughts, maturity of their thoughts, their thinking, their boldness, their courage. You know, people call me a dangerous optimist, Durdamya Ashavadi. You know, I'll tell you, today my confidence in this country has doubled up, actually, by looking at what we saw. I would just give you a brief statistics. Today we are 345 individual members in Pune International Center, 38 international members, 11 corporate members, number of honorary members, all the living Bharat Ratnas are our members, by the way. Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam, who is unfortunately no more with us, he was a member too. In terms of programs, we are very fortunate to have the leadership of Dr. Dilip Padgaonkar. We have done over 100 very high quality programs under his guidance. We have policy papers. What we do actually is a simple three-step process. Deliberate, then engage, and influence. All right? We deliberate amongst ourselves, vichar manthan, as we say. Then we engage with those who matter. All right? For example, if there is a paper that we have created on sanitation for all, I remember Dilip, myself, and Rajiv Kher going to Delhi, meeting the concerned cabinet minister, spending a couple of hours with him, ensuring that our recommendations are not only taken seriously, but they influence the national policy. Just to give an example. So we have done a number of policy papers like corporate governance and making Pune smarter, a whole range of things on energy, environment. I'm not going to give you sort of a list of it, but that's very critical. This year, I must single out two things. One is the Pune dialogue on national security. It has been an incredible success. This is our second, by the way. All right. And that Pune dialogue does not remain as a dialogue within Pune, by the way. There is a recommendation, set of recommendations at policy level, etc., that are made, and they're right with the Defense Minister today, our Honorable Defense Minister. This year also, we had a fantastic two-day meet with more than 100 experts. We had the former, government secretaries. We had the Air Chief Marshals, the Air Marshals, the Generals, the Vice Admirals, whole range of things, whole range of people who actually sort of matter. Also, this National Conference on Social Innovation. You know, we had three, by the way. The first time any conference on social innovation has been held. We always like to be the first, by the way. There is no point in being second. We have to be the first. And we began that, and that has been sort of a roaring success. Last time, we got the corporate leaders, because corporate social responsibility has been now mandated, basically. And therefore, those NGOs were doing some superb social innovation. We got them together and held a dialogue, a productive sort of dialogue. There are other things that we do now that we are in the digital world. We have, fortunately, people like Amit Paranjpe, you know, who are now using that medium to have dialogues on critical issues like higher education, political reforms, for example. One of the issues, by the way, that one is most concerned about is technology-led jobless growth, which will be a disaster for India, because there are young aspirants. 50% of India is less than 25, and jobless growth will create the kind of social disharmony that you cannot just imagine. And therefore, how can we convert it into a job-led growth? What kind of sort of new jobs we need to create? There is a serious discussion that is going on. I think the sum and substance of what we are saying is we do things which are important for India. As Dilip always likes to say, this is not Pune International Center. This is an international center in Pune, by the way. All right? And we sort of live up to that. So having taken these 5 minutes to do my duty as a president of Pune International Center, now I will turn to the event today. So first of all, I'd like to welcome you, Dr. Radhakrishnan, amongst us. I have to do the duty of formally introducing you. You don't need any introduction, but I will do so. As you know, he was the former chairman of Space Commission, Secretary, Department of Space, chairman of ISRO. We are all proud, you know, the Mars orbiter mission, for example. I still remember those wonderful moments we spent together because Mangalayaan had, was on its way to Mars. And I remember Mariko Innovation Foundation, we have a game-changing award, by the way, game-changer award. And that had gone to ISRO at that time. And I remember 22 February, I think it was in 2014 that we actually made 28 March, if I remember correctly, when we had a 15-minute dialogue as Mangalayaan at 10 kilometer per second, I think, was moving towards Mars. You know, it was a thrilling sort of a moment. And at that time, we reflected on a number of things, where ISRO is not just a satellite launcher and the rest of it, but ISRO as an organization, which is galvanizing, let's say, India and the youth, etc. And of course, you will hear more about it, and that is the leadership he has given. After joining as an avionics engineer in Vikram Sarabhai Space Center in 1971, he has spent over 40 years in leading variety of things, the space engineering, space application, program management, and so on. Has, of course, received honors and accolades. Very proud to say that Nature International Weekly in science actually rated him as among the top 10 people who mattered in 2014. Has won several other awards like Alan de Emil Memorial Award, then given by the International Astronomical Federation, Lifetime Achievement Awards, several of them including from ISRO, Ernst & Young. I'm not going to give you a list of that, because it is not by awards that he stands out. It is by what he has done for ISRO that he actually stands out. I must end with a personal note, because I'm sure you are very keen to sort of listen to him. And that personal note is the following. You know, as I said, people call me a dangerous optimist. And I remember giving the convocation address of Delhi University. It was titled as On Embracing a Religion Called Positivism, because I was really tired of the cynicism, negativism that was going on in the country. And in that lecture, I picked up 10 issues, 10 problems, and 10 achievements that we had actually accomplished, although almost making sound impossible possible. And so I pulled out that 22 February 2003 convocation address and the page on which I spoke about what they had done, what ISRO had done. So I'll just read it out to you. So I, of course, describe all their achievements, and then I say, but it is not only the ability to launch our satellites that I'm proud of. It is in our ability to be counted as the best that I take particular pride in. The best. I remember being a part of a committee that reviewed CSIR of South Africa in 1997. I had gone there. Johannesburg, I remember. I remember going to their satellite tracking center outside Pretoria. I asked them, tell me, which is the best satellite image that you get? They took me to a corner and showed to me the imagery which they claimed had the finest resolution, the best in the world. Then I discovered that those pictures were taken from the satellite IRS-1C, and my friends, I am proud to say the I in IRS stood for India. The best. The first. For example, when we did Mangalayaan, you know, we were the first ever country to succeed in the very first effort. Alright? And then I went on to say, should we not be proud that a developing nation such as India was producing the finest satellite imagery in the world? Should we not be proud when Tina Corey, the Director of Application and Training of EOSAT, which is a US-based satellite imagery marketing firm recently, said IRS series of remote sensing satellites is a jewel in the crown. A jewel in the crown. Ladies and gentlemen, we have a speaker today who has produced those jewels in the crown. Dr. Radhakrishnan, thank you very much for accepting our invitation, being here with us, and he's going to speak to us on space exploration, okay, and the emerging scenario, the opportunities, and the challenges. Over to you.
Good evening. Most respected Dr. Mashelkar, Mr. Karandekar, Mr. Gurbani, trustees of the Pune International Center, members of PIC, and the representatives of the intellectual capital of India. It's really an honor for me to be invited for this Foundation Day, that too on the second anniversary of India's Mars Orbiter mission. It is a coincidence, but it happened so. When I got the invitation, I wanted to know from Dr. Mashelkar what should be the topic for the discussion, because I went through the website and I found that the thought leaders are producing papers that are relevant for the country in various disciplines. And I also saw the list of speakers. So I was really humbled my name coming in that line. So I chose the subject today, space exploration, emerging scenario, the opportunities and challenges, for two reasons. One, after my active engagement with space in December 2014, I do give lectures. I wrote a book which is going to come to the stand next month. And this is my current field of study. So I thought I will make a beginning from this platform. And let me just start by paying tributes to the visionaries who made India into a prominent place in the global map. If we can just have the first slide. We have Dr. Baba and Dr. Vikram Sarabhai, who decided that we must do space. And we must do it with a difference. The difference was when US and USSR were going in the bipolar world, putting space as a medium of their competition. Here we had a visionary who said, we want to do it for the development of the country, to address the issues of this country. And in that respect, space technology is relevant for India at a time when we were going to US for the PL-480 Veech. And we had his successor, Professor Satish Dhawan, who always felt that science and technology has a responsibility to the society and we cannot shy away from there, and we need to do that. This is the pillar of ISRO, and it would continue to be our pillar, space applications. I was also happy to be in a place where some of their colleagues of the 60s are there. We had Dr. V.R. Govarikar, you must be knowing about him, a pioneer in the propellant technology that this country has. Whenever any rocket is going up, the hydroxy-terminated polybutadiene, we call it HTPB. It's our specialty, and there is a molecule synthesized by him with all the facilities for processing it to have the rocket that we build. He is no more with us. We have Professor Chitnis, a close associate of Dr. Vikram Sarabhai, Mr. Pramod Kale, still very active in Pune University. And when I entered this auditorium, I was really touched by seeing another gentleman, Mr. Kumar Chandragupta, K.C. Chandragupta, is a dynamite. And when I joined in the year 1971, he was there in the same room. He was about 3 years senior to me. And these are the people who made India what it is in space. So let me pay my tributes to all of them before I start. Next. We say space is the last frontier of humankind. And our boundary starts at about 100 kilometers above the surface of Earth. Why that 100 kilometer? The density of the atmosphere comes down. Lift and drag, as we talk about, loses its significance at that point of time. It is called Kármán line. That is where aerodynamics stops and astronautics starts. But we do not have a limit
the objects made by the space scientists, technologists all over the world are today in the solar system. I remember the JPL director, Jet Propulsion Laboratory director, telling, we have 25 satellites in the solar system. That is one thing we have done. Observation using these objects have been done to understand not only the galaxy and even beyond. So we have no limits in that respect. When we come to the people who are engaged, today there are 83 countries in the world who have something or other to do with space. They may not be making satellites or launch vehicles, but they know how to use the data coming from the space science explorations or use the benefits of communication, navigation, and remote sensing technologies. These people assemble in a UN body called the Committee on Peaceful Use of Outer Space. That shows the breadth of this activity we talk about. In the world today, there are approximately 9 lakh professionals engaged in the space activity across all these countries, and the universities, academia, who are the real innovators in this field. If you come to the economics, many of you are aware of the term OECD, the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development. There are about 40 plus countries who are members of it. India, Russia, China, Brazil, who are spacefaring nations, are not part of it. There are a few statistics brought out in the year 2014, just to show the magnitude of this. The space economy of these 43 countries together come to something like $256 billion. In the year 2030. And that was approximately $150 to $160 billion in 2011. In 2 years, it has gone up from 150 to 250 plus. And that's the time we said the world economy is in difficult stage. One of the conclusion is the relevance of space, the importance of space for all these nations even during that period. That is one of the indicator. And if you go deep into 256 crores, you will find one interesting factor. About 60% of it is contributed by the downstream services coming out of the satellite systems. And those who build satellites and rockets, that come to nearly 10%. So there is a large value chain from the time we launch a rocket and put a satellite in orbit, and finally making that part and parcel of everybody's life. And in India, we can of course see the farmer or the fisherman getting benefit out of this system. So that is the vastness of the space that we talk about. Let me just say a few things on the history of space before we come to the emerging trends of the recent past. We all know 70 years ago, the first rocket took off from the Jet Propulsion Laboratory. And soon, we also had the V2 rocket, the German rocket. And that's the time we also had a picture of Earth taken from a camera mounted on that rocket. That is the first and foremost thing. And if you look at 4th October, that is the time the first artificial satellite made by human being went up. That is the Sputnik 1. And world celebrates this day. And that whole week is called World Space Week. India too celebrates. America came into the picture a few months later. And we call that's the beginning of modern space age. We had the famous Kennedy statement to put the human being in moon. He said it's not only challenging, it is going to be a major step in space exploration. It's a difficult task that we will be doing. And an event which will make a major impact for humankind. All of us remember that period. Of course, that was the time of space race in the bipolar world, Russia and USA, or the USSR and USA. But Russia had the first success in a mission to moon, that was somewhere in 1966. But in 1969, we had the human being putting the foot on moon. But somewhere in 1978, moon did not become an object of interest for this community. For almost 10 years, there was a lull in the activity. And the renewed interest in exploration of moon came in the 90s later, and many joined: Japan, China, India, and US and Russia continued their efforts, and it is continuing in various ways. So that is one part of it. 45 years ago, the Mars became a subject of interest. And today we have the Curiosity sitting there from 2012. It's a wonderful lander, and it is doing things as the human being on Earth is asking it to do. As more and more information come, the scientists here command the Curiosity to do much and more things. It's almost like an adaptive, dynamic robot sitting there. We also had a new era in launch vehicle technology called the reusable launch vehicle. See if you can have the same hardware reused or rotated. If you can have about 100 flights using the same space shuttle, then it is going to be cheaper, low-cost access to space. But US went ahead. Of course, they had a few flights. They had two accidents also. And in 2011, they decided to retire the space shuttle. So that has been a major milestone. Russia proved the technology. They made Buran and closed that. So that is a major development that took place over the last few decades in history of space. We went ahead further, and if you come to the recent years, we could see this bipolar world changing into an area of cooperation. The sheer fact that from a small planet, we are looking at the whole universe. We are looking at efforts which require technologies to be developed, challenging technologies to be developed. Costs are high. Everyone felt it is prudent that countries cooperate. Today, we have US and Russia cooperating together after the shuttle era. This is a very major development that has taken place from a space race to space cooperation. Russia concentrated on the platforms, the space stations, Mir station, and before that, Salyut, Almaz. We had the Skylab of US, but later we saw a major international cooperation taking place, that is the International Space Station. Started in the 90s. Building is still going on. There are several countries who are the owners of it. And it is open today for experiments for other countries too. It's a very major area in human presence in the solar system. We also progressed further. If you look at the concept of a robo-naut came into the picture. If you are looking at the space exploration, we talk about robots, you also talk about a human being present there. Human being has the cognitive capability. Once he or she is there, they can decide what new thing they need to do without waiting for the people from the ground to command, like what they do for the Curiosity. But to take a human being to space, to keep the human being there, bring back safely, is very, very difficult task. Whereas for the robots, one can do that. If you look at the robo-naut, it has the dexterity. It can tighten a screw. And if a human being sitting in the space station is able to show that, it can be mimicked by the robo-naut. For activities in space manufacturing, the role of robo-naut is extremely important. So this is one major development that took place in the recent past. This happened in the year 2011. We see also a trend of the private sector getting in a major way in the space activities, especially in US. We know about the Elon Musk, and they also had a safe re-entry into the sea in the recent past. We also had the Amazon getting into the space activity. So there are several things happening in the space missions. But when you look at Mars? Why the renewed interest in understanding more about Moon? It is essentially with an objective of a habitat in Mars. That's on one side. The second one is to know much more about the evolution of Earth, the evolution of life on Earth. So these are the two drivers for the planetary exploration as we talk about. And what today America has done or is doing at the moment is to create a habitat on Earth which is almost equal to what you would be having in Mars. So there's a very major step. And as you know, if you have to have a travel to Mars, which is 55 million kilometers when it is closest and 400 million kilometers when it is farthest, and you can undertake this journey on opportune geometries only once in 26 months, the human being has to be kept in the space environment for a pretty long time. So they are trying to have that kind of a system. So first and foremost, the International Station had a one-year crew. One Russian and American, they stayed there for 1 year. That is a very major development. And this habitat that is being put, next step two, that's the mission, with $65 billion, as they quote today, that is another major step that is taking place in this area. And of course, as we said, India got into the planetary exploration after it did the moon exploration. And what we showed to the world there is there is a different way of doing planetary exploration. The MAVEN mission, which was going parallel with our mission, took 11 years from concept to fruition. It took almost 10 times the cost of what we incurred for the Mars orbiter mission. That was their 22nd mission. They had a few advanced instruments. And for launching, they had a rocket which had almost 10 times more power than what our PSLV had. And our PSLV can put 1.3 ton mass into geostationary transfer orbit. It's an elliptical orbit. Their vehicle could put 13 tons. That was what they had. But we had our novel ways of doing it. That's a different subject to talk about. But India showed to the world that there is a different way of doing planetary exploration. That is our greatness. Now, if you look at the recent trends, a few things are coming out very clearly, that when there were only very few countries in this field, today there are large number. From two, Russia and America, who were asked in the International Geophysical Year to do something new for this, today we have 83 countries who are interested in that. If you look at the industry, industry is there in a very major way in the space activity. If you look at the academic institutions, they are there in a very major way. The Jet Propulsion Laboratory itself is an offshoot from the California Institute of Technology, Caltech. That is where they started the propulsion activity. The story is that professor who was doing this clumsy propulsion was asked to go to the hilltop and do that, and that is where Jet Propulsion Laboratory is today. So many of these innovations, many of these path-breaking developments are coming out of that community. So we have the brain as well as muscle coming out of it. The industrial production methodologies, like what you have in automobile industry, are all getting into producing the rockets or satellites. And here we have the former vice president of Larsen & Toubro, associated with the space program from the 70s in making the motor cases for all our rockets, SLV-3 onwards. And they also got into the development of satellite systems. We have the Valchandar Industries, again, another major partner. And when today we say that a PSLV goes up, which is again happening on Monday morning at 9 o'clock, 120 industrial firms of the country, large, medium, small, micro, participate in that. 80% of what the PSLV has is done, the value addition is done by the Indian industry. This is the Indian example. This happens when you talk to the colleagues in Europe, the European Space Agency, or you go to NASA, all these places it is happening. This is a new development. It was an excitement to do science, but today economy has come to the picture. There is competition. Why the countries come to India for launching their satellites on PSLV? One is the reliability of PSLV, second is the price. We say, the Indian studies show, U. Shankar of Madras School of Economics has brought out this a decade ago. When we build satellites and launch vehicles in India, we incur almost half the cost of what other countries do. That brings an effect of cost effectiveness. So competition is a very major factor now in the market. We call it space industry today. And if you look at the supply chain, there are countries, but being a strategic subject, there are associated issues on getting things which are essential for space. And why do we say there are special things for space? By the mere fact that the environment in which these rockets are going up and the environment in which the satellites have to function for 10 to 15 years make the choices very narrow. We require components and systems which have the heritage to work in the space environment. And what is that harsh space environment we talk about? When a satellite is in orbit, certainly the gravity plays a role from the celestial bodies. One can calculate that. That is one part. Sun provides a lot of difficulties for the satellites that is in the orbit. Various, the plasma, the solar flares all affect us. So we need to worry about that part of it. If you look at one boon for the Earth is the magnetosphere. But also it has attracted a lot of particles, charged particles, which are in two belts, the Van Allen radiation belt. And when we put the satellites up, the electronic systems get affected by those particles. And we need to have components which are radiation hardened, which can withstand. In fact, this is one of the specialty of our Chandragupta sir. So these are the kinds of things make the supply chain very critical for the space activity. Technology denials for various reasons happen in this case. And if you go further, programmatically, a lot of new things are happening. Politically, economically, commercially, there are things happening in this world. So what is that we can look at for the future? Look at the future is cooperation. Countries coming together, we have the capability collectively to look beyond solar system. We have the ability to make our presence, human or robonaut or robotics, to look at these objects, our neighboring planets to start with. So this is a very major trend that is taking place in the field of space today. And if you look at what are the opportunities? Opportunities are of different kinds that I just put on the slide here. If you look at the entire space, we can divide it into three areas. Essentially, the space exploration, that is the exciting part. Space technology, where we talk about the satellites, launch vehicles and all. And then finally, the space application, which is centered around three systems as of now: communication, navigation, and the Earth observation or remote sensing. Let me start with the statement that Dr. Mashelkar made. In 1995, when we launched that IRS-1C that he mentioned, India had the best civilian remote sensing satellite of the world. That is a landmark for Indian space program. 5 meter spatial resolution. An object of 5 by 5 square meter could be deciphered from an orbit which is almost 600 and odd kilometer. That is a capability that we had. Earth stations in US, in Europe, in several parts of Asia started receiving this data on commercial basis. And even today, our remote sensing satellite constellation, looking at meteorology, looking at atmosphere, looking at oceans, looking at the natural resources, water resources, and even for cartography, is considered one of the best remote sensing satellite constellation. What we had in the last few years is joint building of remote sensing satellites. The French Space Agency and ISRO together built a satellite, some of the instruments by them, some of the instrument by us, satellite by us, launch by us, and we had that in the year 2011. Essentially, it was a contribution from these two countries to the global community to understand the climate. What is the heat transport from the equatorial region to the rest of the globe? That was the theme of that satellite, megatropics. Soon, we had a satellite called SARAL that is again built by the French Space Agency and India together in a similar mode, looking at the ocean, the wave heights. There's a new dimension in oceanography and understanding the circulation in ocean. But what is happening today is NASA and India together are building a satellite called NISR, NASA ISRO Synthetic Aperture Radar Satellite, to look at some of the issues like disasters. And the people who are in the front row will know what is that significance of NASA coming together with ISRO to build a satellite in which one instrument is built by them, another instrument is built by them, and we build a whole satellite, get it launched on our GSLV by the year 2019-20. It's a very major reversal of several things that used to happen in the past. It's a beginning of a different working relationship, which in fact started with Chandrayaan 1, where they had 2 instruments on our satellite, which led to a major discovery. We also had our collaboration in the Mars orbiter mission that we had, and that continue in the future missions that are being planned. So these are the kinds of cooperative efforts taking place in this area of space today in Earth observation. Because any Earth observation satellite goes around from pole to pole, doesn't make a difference, it sees all part of the Earth. So if people on Earth can collaborate, we can reduce the expenditure that we need to put for getting this facility. So share the data, do things together, leverage on each other's strength. So this is one lesson coming there. If you look at communication, for example, 1980s, we had our first INSAT satellite. INSAT-1B came. People were not very happy at that time to switch over from the traditional communication system to satellite-based communication system. It was a difficult job to convince why you require satellites for this. There was optics fiber, terrestrial systems available. But then we were able to convince everyone, saying that there are specific advantages, whether it is sharing larger routes or go to inaccessible area or to have flexibility in the communication network, satellites are going to be important. But the whole scene reversed a few years ago. The requirement for communication satellites became much and much more. New services came, and today with almost 200 plus transponders, we are having a communication infrastructure for the country. But in terms of technology, when we had our first Apple satellite launched in 1980, that could give a power output of 100 watts. In the last few years, whatever we launched, the GSAT 8 onwards, that had almost 5 to 6 kilowatts. But world is looking at today for 15 to 20 kilowatts coming from the same satellite. We started with the life of 7 years for the satellite. But anyone in the business will know, if we can enhance the life of the satellite, it is more economical. For the same investment, you get more returns. Today, we talk about 12 to 15 years life in the orbit. So, second aspect. Third one, the launch cost. Today, if you have to put a satellite of 15 to 20 kilowatts output power, we talk about 6 to 7 tons to be put. We have GSLV which can put 2 tons. Beyond that, today we are going for foreign launches. So if we can reduce the mass of the satellite using better technology, the launch cost will come down. So the world is looking at, India is also looking at how to reduce, increase the power at the same time reduce. And one important element that is coming out is the electric propulsion system. If you have to have the life guaranteed for the satellite, you require fuel, oxidizer stored there for all the maneuvers to be done. Almost 2 ton of the satellite is going to be just the propellant for that purpose. So if we can replace that with electric propulsion, we can still have a satellite of 4 ton, but technologically that's a very complex affair. The second thing is the electronic components, how we can miniaturize, how we can reduce the mass. This is another direction. So all these are happening, especially in communication satellites. It's a real business, actually, communication satellite. And where does India stand? A few years ago, we built 2 communication satellites for the European customer on commercial basis. And we had a partnership with one of the organizations which make state-of-the-art transponders for that purpose. So India is there, like I said, about the remote sensing satellites earlier. Navigation is an area which is there from the last year. GPS is very well known. In fact, navigation means GPS for everyone today because it's the first system which has a global presence. GLONASS of Russia, which is almost complete with a global system of 25 to 30 satellite constellation. Europe is building, it is called Galileo. China is building a system. Japan is building a system. What India did over the last several years is to have its own regional navigation system. And here again, we have a novelty. They all look at 25 to 30 satellite constellation. We said we are going to look at India and its environs, 1500 kilometers from our border. And we are doing that with 7 satellites, put in at 36,000 kilometer altitude. And we have that constellation already in place. The last one was put very recently, and it gives you a strategic capability, self-reliance in getting navigation signals of 10 meter accuracy. And we can always use this in conjunction with GLONASS or the GPS, etc. So this is a capability that India has built in. So the world is there with the navigation, providing several services by itself. Like aircraft navigation, India today has a system along with the Airports Authority of India where the takeoff and landing or even the onward route, everything is controlled using these systems. So there is a very major development. But if you have a synergy of all these things together, we can do several new things. For example, in disaster management, that's what we are doing. That's where India has shown the impact to the whole world. We had the Phailin cyclone in 2013. That was the time when there was a lot of criticism against using this 450 crores for the Mars orbiter mission. People said it is a wastage. We said it is 4 rupees per head of the country. If you lose one cup of tea, you can have Mars orbiter mission. That was the argument. But just before the launch, a few weeks before the launch, we had that cyclone. And 4 lakh people were evacuated from Orissa and Andhra using the early warnings provided by India Meteorology Department. Very effectively they did it. And their first input is a satellite data, 48 hours in advance. We can monitor the systems, and precisely the modeling team will tell where it will hit the land and what is going to be the surge height, how much area is going to be inundated, what the relief commissioner should do to evacuate these people to the safe places. So this was a very major supporting evidence for the way we do it. And you cannot certainly calculate what is that value of 4 lakh human beings if they had problem. Plus, of course, the other lives of animals or infrastructure. We had the violent cyclone again next year. Similar thing was done in that area. So this continues. So apart from the farmer and fisherman, there is a very major area where communication satellite system and remote sensing satellite system help them together. And we work in tandem with the Ministry of Home Affairs in managing these disasters. In providing information, a database to the people in the ground on what they need to do for a rapid response. And when the navigation satellite is added to that group, then we can have location-based services. Today, many of you are aware of on your mobile itself how to navigate. But for the people who are doing resource management and many other services, it provides a major boost. So this is something which is happening in the world. Convergence of communication, earth observation, and navigation satellite system. The second aspect of it is, whenever you require, you should be able to launch, because we depend, I use the word, we depend on these satellites which are in the orbit. Today, India has nearly 30 satellites for communication and remote sensing and navigation. If one communication satellite gets into a problem, you will see the impact all around the country. Some ATMs may not work. You may not see some TV channels. It is part and parcel of your life. But if you have to replace them in orbit on time, you require capability for putting those satellites. That is the launch vehicle capability. We have our PSLV and our GSLV. Last fortnight, we had the third successful flight of the GSLV with Indian cryogenic stage. It was a technology milestone in 2014 when we did it first, and we repeated that. PSLV again on 9th morning, it is going. It's 30 plus successful flights. That's what it has done. What next? Next is doubling the capacity of the communication satellite. That is the LVM3, which is today in the final phase to get into its ability to put a satellite into orbit, almost 3 to 4 tons. And what we are guaranteeing there also is low cost access. For the same kind of lift of mass, 320 ton of PSLV will put 1.3 ton into an orbit, where this can put with double D mass, 3.5 times satellite mass. That means we are going to reduce the cost of putting satellite into orbit. We are going to enhance India's capability to put the communication satellite into orbit. Then, of course, we call this a space asset, the satellites which are in the orbit. And there is a threat for them which come from the space debris. There are 16,000 particles, objects in these orbits which are going at a very fast rate, and if they hit any of these orbiting satellites, they can kill that. 16,000 orbits. So one need to understand where it is, model them, and also predict where they are going to come in our proximity, and like in space traffic, move our satellites, which are our operational satellites. So this is a capability that we are developing, and India is there. And if you look at the left side, we call the space manufacturing. If you are talking about habitat, if you are talking about International Space Station, which is around the Earth, to a future date for Mars or as an interim point, Moon, we have to have the ability in space manufacturing. And as I told earlier, the human in loop and the space robotics or the robonaut, as we talk about, and the exciting field of looking at the solar system. I mentioned about the connection between the last and the second one. But when we do space exploration, One is understanding more about our universe, our solar system. But that demands very cutting-edge technologies to be developed. And those finally get into the satellites that we are building, and finally it enables better application. Just to give an example, when we had the Mars Orbiter mission, simple issue because the distance is the communication delay. A signal from the satellite will take up to 20 minutes to come to the ground station. If there is a problem in the satellite, the ground controller will know 20 minutes afterwards. And for him to send a corrective signal, again the 20 minutes time is taken. This 40 minutes plus, anything can happen in that satellite, it can be dead. So we did transfer this ground controller's knowledge as algorithms into the satellite. We call it autonomy. We enable the satellite to take its own decisions on shifting from a primary system to the standby when there is a problem after looking at the health. When to do the operations. Worst case, if it gets into a serious problem, how to be in the safe condition. All this we did. There was a test in June 2015 when Mars Orbiter was not visible to Earth, Sun was in between. For 2 to 3 weeks, the satellite managed by itself. If there were any flaw in the algorithm, a wrong decision was taken by the satellite, we would have lost the satellite. That's the test of it. Now, how does it feed to the remote sensing or communication satellite? Today, if a remote sensing satellite is looking at the forest, for example, it will go round and round. Every day you look at whether there is a change taking place. But if you can put a smartness into this satellite, the satellite can find out which are the trouble areas. Where the deforestation is taking place, it will find out and go and take picture of that area only. So a smartness is brought into the remote sensing satellite system. If you look at the communication satellite system, you can manage. It manages by itself. Its life will be also better. It becomes a more efficient system. So technologies will come to that stage. The beginning of it was the remote sensing itself, because space scientists were looking with the telescope, the sky. Somebody decided, I will look back at the Earth, and then came the remote sensing. So that's the relevance of the space exploration missions, other than understanding more about us into the practical terms and finally getting into the bottom line of space economy. So this is another major direction that is happening. What next is the next question. You would have heard in the recent past, India did two very major important missions. One mission was called Reusable Launch Vehicle Technology Demonstrator. People said Indian shuttle. It is not shuttle. It is only looking at some of the technologies that are important for the reusability. Essentially, if you are looking at any of these explorations, going to Mars, going to Moon, and bringing back something from there, whether human being or any resource, the first and foremost thing there is re-entry into the atmosphere. I mentioned our territory starts from 100 kilometers. But when from outside, when from the orbits, an object come at very fast speed, the kinetic energy will get transferred into thermal energy, a lot of process take place. But finally, that craft has to be protected against high temperature. The key word is high temperature in all this mission that we are going to see in the future. High temperature materials. Hypersonic speeds of Mach number 6 and above. Now this is the technology regime that we need to address. If you look at a rocket which is 320 tons, I said, about 60 to 65% is just the propellants required to give the power. Propellant has two major parts. One is the fuel, one is the oxidizer. Oxidizer itself will be about 80%. So if we can extract oxygen from the atmosphere during the initial phase of the flight, we can reduce the mass to be lifted up. That is what we tried in the air breathing propulsion experiment very recently. For 7 seconds, they were able to see that happening, taking the oxygen from the air but we deal with hypersonic speeds of Mach number 6 and more. So this is something happening, and I should tell actually, Mr. Kotwal and his group made a hypersonic wind tunnel where we can test these objects for that kind of speeds. What we do is we make a model and we simulate the airflow and see how this model behaves. So this is something very, very critical. The other part of the activity is the human presence, whether it is robot or otherwise human being will be in the loop. Now, what is required for understanding, safely taking him, keeping them and bringing him back? What happens to him or her, bioastronautics? And when we talk about habitats in these planets, Mars to start with, intermediate step even Moon, astrobiology is another area that we are going to look at. Again, why we are going to have habitats? There must be an end goal. And if you look at the origin of universe, the way the stars have formed, the way the planets are formed, the way Earth and its neighboring planets are there, there are a lot of things that we could make use of, harness as resources. When you talk about Moon, there is helium-3. There are precious minerals. When you talk about Mars again, there are similar things to happen. So there will be an interest. I'm not talking about the immediate decade or so, but in a far future, these are all going to happen in the area of space. And we must have the ability to reach there and bring that back to Earth. So we require capabilities of vehicles to do that. Today in the world, US is doing a vehicle which they expect to be of commercial nature along with industry for going for planets beyond Earth, that is Mars and all. So there are areas in which challenges are taking place. Along with that, we are also seeing the international cooperation taking place in a very major way. And certainly space is going to play an important role, but the bottom line of it is for India, the space application still will be the bedrock of our future program. Sir, I stop here. Probably we could have questions and answers. Let me just start saying, yesterday I met two of your trustees. We had dinner together. So I told him, this is going to be like my PhD thesis defense. I don't claim I will know answers for all the questions, but whatever I can. There are certain questions on which I will not be giving an answer. Let me say that.
Yeah, while the mics would come in the audience and on the stage, another huge round of applause for that wonderful speech. You know what, there is one reason you would thank us for sure, that we have recorded this, which means we'll be able to play it again and again on the YouTube till we get some essence of it, some parts of it, as we have understood some, and we would want to listen it again to understand more of it. So if it's okay, we'll take a few questions now. We'll go first to Amit. Yeah, we'll...
You briefly talked about what next after GSLV and in terms of increasing the payload to 3.5 times. But would be useful if you can share a little bit more details on that, especially, I mean, you know, China is talking about 10 to 15 ton payload capacity. Ariane is already out there. Soyuz is already there. And Saturn V and the new Falcon Heavy that SpaceX is talking about. I mean, we don't want to get there, but that's 100 tons or more. So just to stay competitive, I mean, do we have a plan to get to at least 10 tons or beyond?
Yes. My first part of the answer you yourself told, so I don't need to say that. Today, if you look at PSLV, it's a versatile launcher for the lower levels of payloads, and there is a lot of demand. Some people say 10 to 15% of the future demand of the world will be of that class of satellites. And in remote sensing, there is a trend for smaller satellites. So that market is taken care of, and we have a niche there. If you look at GSLV, it can put 2 ton into the geostationary transfer orbit. But today, if you look at the communication satellites mass projection, there is a class which is around 3 to 4 ton, large market. There is also a market which is going up to 6 ton. But what is happening there? These 6 ton teams are trying to bring it down to 4 ton. We are using electric propulsion. So that is number one. If they use electric propulsion, they will take almost 6 months to reach the final orbit. But it's okay for them because you save in the launch cost. Our GSLV Mark 3 or LVM 3 will cater to a market of 3 to 4 tons. With some improvement in the future, it can go to maybe 4.5 ton. Why I am saying so? Because PSLV started with 850 and today we are at even 1850. So it's possible. What next? Today we are looking at solid propulsion, liquid propulsion and cryogenic propulsion. We also have a development of 210 thrust semi-cryogenic engine. Here we are talking about 7 ton, 12 ton, etc. And for the lower stages of a rocket, semi-cryogenics or solid propulsion are ideal from the specific density, the paraphernalia required to take them actually. So we are doing a study at the moment of 6 to almost 12 ton, what can be done. And we want to do it in a modular way. Because what happened in Ariane 5 is it is made for 11 to 12 ton, two satellites. Unless you get a good partner, it is going to be suboptimal. That's why they want to Ariane 6 for 6 ton. So we are going for that. That means you change the strap-ons as you require, you get a major. So this plan is there.
Thank you, sir. I'm just looking around and we would have a question first at the fag end of it and then we'll come back again in the front. The fag end of it, yes, we'll ask to the young man and please be brief and ask the question. Thank you.
Yeah. With the advancement of robonauts, will it mean the end of the manned missions?
No, I said it's a good pitch. You require both. You require the cognitive capability of human being and the flexibility and easiness of putting a robot there. Robonaut is somewhere in between. In a space station, if you have to go out and do some manufacturing, this robonaut can do it. So what we require is a mix of all these things together.
Thank you, sir. We'll take one question in the front and again we'll come back.
You mentioned Elon Musk in passing. I just wondered, what will it take for an Indian entrepreneur to have similar aspirations, similar plans for being in the space?
As I said, when the PSLV is going up, 80% is added by them in terms of value. But they are doing today specific elements. ISRO today has to produce the rockets and satellites in large number. And if it continues to do that, we may not be able to focus on what we really need to do. Future technologies, research and development. So a few years back, we put this concept of an industrial conglomerate taking the overall responsibility for producing operational launch vehicles and operational satellites, communication satellites especially. So this is evolving. Various models of doing it, with ISRO being part of it, with the private sector, public sector, and all this tier 1, tier 2, 3, 4 coming into the picture. So this is happening today. That is for the systems which have already been developed. There are startups who are looking at this area on what they can do on its own. And I'm sure there will be people coming up. So the first step is even the established technologies, how to do it. Ariane Space, for example, is an industrial consortium of several countries coming together. Its job is only produce Ariane 5 and then launch it. They don't worry about science. That is done by the National Space Agency. But there is a very strong association with the French Space Agency because rocket finally you have to architecture it and also ensure the quality is intact. So there is a role for all this into the picture. So all these 120 have to be brought together as a chain where they can finally deliver a rocket at Sriharikota or a satellite which is ready to go. This is the next step in that area.
Thank you, sir. I think as sir suggested, we'll take Nisar's question, we'll come there. We'll have a couple of questions more. So that's where you suggested, sir, we'll take Nisar's question and then we'll come to you.
Sir, thank you very much. It was so absorbing that I felt even if I blinked, I might miss something. Sir, my question comes from this point that since you have a lot of sensor data coming in and you have a lot of equipment, is there any way where you can visualize things here on Earth with real-time data?
Yeah, actually this virtual reality is one area where we are working with the remote sensing data that we have, and we have three-dimensional data. We get also terrain information. We also get this data periodically. So this is generated for various training purposes. Even for the resource managers today, it would be available. So this is a good area. Swayam, I was there with the team yesterday. Yeah. But Swayam, what it is doing is basically communication. It's a ham type of communication. And they are looking at the next generation of satellite where they can look at the solar pressure for raising the orbit of the spacecraft. But what you spoke about today is in the realm of National Remote Sensing Center. They are the agency trying to generate this kind of models, virtual realities.
What are the type of experiments on basic research that we are planning in any of these to understand the physical phenomena in the outer space?
What we tried to do at that time was to do the terrain mapping at resolutions far better than what the US mission Clementine gave. So this is what we have got. We know about the terrain today. If you are talking about a landing site, we can look at the data and decide where to go and land. What the NASA instrument gave is a knowledge about the water molecules. That is about Chandrayaan. As far as Mars orbital mission is concerned, the primary goal, as we told, 85% of the mark we were looking at for the technology objective, whether we can go and orbit around Mars, which we did. And the life is there to make observations. So we had a couple of themes there. One theme was presence of methane. Presence of methane so far had been studied using ground instruments. Curiosity made the measurement at a site where it was, but we were looking at the larger atmosphere. So we had sensors for that. We also wanted to know whether this methane is produced from the biological activity or geological activity. For that, we had one more instrument in thermal infrared band. So that is one theme. The second, we always talk about the water. And if you look at the pictures of Mars, people used to say there was water, there is channels, etc., etc. So what is happening in this atmosphere? And an interesting subject is the deuterium and hydrogen ratio people try to study. So there are instruments done for that. So these were the scientific elements of Mars orbiter mission. When you look at AstroSat, I did not mention that. AstroSat is an observatory to look at the sky. And the speciality of AstroSat is it is doing this observation in different wavelengths. It is called a multi-wavelength space observatory. 2012, when the Committee on Space Research, the global community with about 70 countries participated, what they said is for astronomy in the world, AstroSat is going to be one of the major contributions in the next 5 years. It is happening. And the uniqueness of the science mission is time is available, of course, for those people who developed it from TIFR, Indian Institute of Astrophysics, ISRO, etc. Time is available for the Indian scientific community if there is a theme for that. So time is available for the international community. And I'm sure the Pune colleagues have been at it, and what I understand is a beautiful paper which has come up recently from Ayuka on the AstroSat. If you look at Aditya, we are interested in understanding Sun, but from Earth. Initially, we thought we will go to 600 kilometers, from there we will study. And why 600 kilometers? Atmosphere is a barrier for all the observations. But today, the thought process is we should go far beyond to 1.5 million kilometers. It's called Lagrangian point 1, where we will put this to study the solar corona. So this is the scientific theme that we are working in. And to guide all this, we have got in the country a National Committee of Space Scientists. It's chaired by Professor U.R. Rao. So they look at what are the themes of interest and then what instrument has to be developed and how to conduct the experiments. So this is another part of it. And what you require in the country in this area is people who can have original ideas, people who can bring new instruments, not do something what others have done, and then bring new science in this area. So this is what is required for the future if you have to make use of all this satellite capability. Abroad, if your instrument has to fly in a spacecraft, you go through a tough process to get it evaluated. Today, here there is opportunity. What we require is people who can build those instruments and use the data and decipher things for the future. Thank you.
Thank you. So we'll have last question and I will go to the last row.
Hello, sir. Is ISRO planning any lander missions Curiosity on Mars?
Okay. Chandrayaan 2, we will be having a rover. And to take that rover to the surface of Moon, we have a lander also. Originally, we had this Chandrayaan 2 planned in the year 2008-09, where a Russian lander, a Russian rover, was supposed to be flown in our GSLV. We were supposed to just provide that satellite in which these two will be put. But slowly, when they got into problem with their interplanetary missions, the Phobos grant, for example, in 2011, they said, we have a different strategy. And that is a blessing in this case for us. We decided we will make the rover, we will make the lander. And what is important for a lander? From 7 to 8 kilometers per second, you have to bring it down to zero on the surface of Moon. You have to land with these four legs, it should not topple. So you have to reduce the velocity, number one. You have to also look at the terrain, take pictures, process it inside, and steer the lander. We are developing that in the country today. And that's our beginning for what you call the space habitat related development. Thank you.
We almost towards the concluding part of it. Take another 7-8 minutes. There is so much more. I'm sure there are so many good questions. I'm sorry we couldn't get all of that we wanted to. But as I said, we'll be putting it on YouTube so that we'll be able to look at it again. So, as I was mentioning, it's been 5 years. It's been 5 years since we started. We organized lots of programs. We met some of you many, many times and looking forward to meet many, many times. I happen to stand around in almost all the programs and connect with you. But you know what? As you all appreciate, anything that goes on well on the stage, there is something that's working behind the stage. So this year, as we're completing 5 years, with permission of the chair and chief guest, we would like to take a minute and a half to felicitate two of our colleagues who make many, many things happen behind the curtain. So if you all allow, may I request on stage Mrs. Kiran Pardeshi, who manages the PIC team. So thank you, Kiran. Thanks for all the wonderful work that you do behind the curtains. May I now request Mr. Tejas Pawar, who works as the admin executive but managed every nut and bolt that makes this huge machine run smoothly. That's Tejas. Thank you, sir. If you could please take the seat. Thank you all for indulging that minute and a half of your precious time. I have two wonderful things ahead of us before we conclude the program. First, we'll be requesting Dr. Mashilkar to give his concluding remarks, and then I'll be requesting Mr. Karandikar to give his vote of thanks. Dr. Mashilkar.
I'll be very, very brief, just make 3 points. I think the first thing is that this has been a great Foundation Day lecture, really lifting our spirit that yes, India can. And how have they done it? It's a denial-driven innovation, by the way. Things are not simply available, right? Cryogenic engine, US said, no, we will not give it. And we said, thank you very much. We'll develop our own. And you heard what happened next. I remember Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam, he always used to say, strength respects strength. You extend your hand, people will see what is the strength in your hand before shaking hand. And if it is weak, they wouldn't. And you can quite clearly see the same US, NASA now is becoming partner with them after we have shown what our strength is. So I think that deserves an applause. The second point I want to make is that I always talk about talent, technology and trust. They are a fantastic example of talent, technology and trust. Today, he didn't mention, Dr. Radhakrishnan didn't mention about some other aspects about building entire ISRO, because it is all young talent. You understand, the people, young people behind who have done it and the kind of trust that they have. And in one of the lectures that I had heard, he talked about that. In fact, the interaction that I had with you, I remember 15 minutes, mainly it was focused on the young and the way you build talent and what difference it makes each time we succeed here. You know, the wave of excitement among the young people that goes, the number of young people that apply to you, you find it absolutely impossible, you get flooded and so on and so forth. I think that is extremely important in the country to keep them excited that great things are happening here, you know. At the end of it, the Indian genes don't have to express in Silicon Valley, they have to express in Indus Valley. And that's what they are doing, basically. I think that is very important. And one of the remarkable things I remember, Dr. Radhakrishnan, you mentioned, was that one of the most critical command, the first command, if it had gone wrong, everything would have gone wrong, was made, was allowed to be made by Dr. Radhakrishnan in someone, young Mishra, who was in early 20s, by the way. That's what they did. That is the kind of trust that they have. So I think you are an exemplar as far as that is concerned. And the final point, the third point I want to make, is that it is rather remarkable that Mangalayaan's space probe orbiting Mars since 24 September, right? 2 years. 24 September. Today is also 24 September, our foundation day. All right, so there is something remarkable about these two launches of Pune International Center as well as Mangalayaan. So thank you very much. Every year we'll remember you. Every year we celebrate our foundation day. Thank you. Our vote of thanks and gratitude go to Dr. Radhakrishnan for accepting our invitation, coming here and talking to us about space exploration and the connected subjects. As a token of appreciation from PIC and all of us, I would request our President Dr. Mashelkar to present a memento to Dr. Radhakrishnan. I am the most important program committee, Dr. Padagaukar and Amitabh Malik, who have given us some great programs, and also all my colleagues in PIC, whether they are trustees or members or well-wishers. Also, thanks to our colleagues in Yashoda for providing us this wonderful infrastructure, and also members from PIC for helping us to organize the programs. Thanks also to our friends from the media, and most important, thanks to each and every one of you for attending the program today. Thank you very much.
Thank you all. We announce the program concluded. Thank you.